Our Father, this is a week like no other week in the year. This is a Christmas gets a day, maybe a night and a day, Christmas Eve and Christmas Day. But Easter gets a whole week, runs from Palm Sunday to Easter Sunday. And Father, the intent is for it not just to be a week, but the intent of Easter was to be for eternity. I trust that on this Sunday, that we will pause and reflect on nothing but the blood washes away our sin. It requires an attitude of humility for us to come to a point to say that we are sinners. None of us like to acknowledge it. We all know it. The one who denies it the most probably knows it the best. But Father, it requires us to be humble, to say that we are a sinner and we're in need of a Savior, that we're not big enough, we're not smart enough, we're not wise enough, we're not creative enough to find our own way out, but we must humbly come to one who humbly has come to us. Your Son entered this world quietly on a Christmas Eve in a little town called Bethlehem. He entered Jerusalem unassumingly on the back of a small donkey. But Father, it was not the arrival of your Son in Bethlehem or Jerusalem that was important. It was his exit from a tomb on Golgotha's hill that makes all the difference in the world. And I trust today we will sit and stand in awe of the risen Son of God, who wants nothing more than to forgive us of our sin and to be our Savior. For those of us who have appropriated that truth for our own lives, may we incredibly, powerfully offer praise to you today. And for those of us who might be here and we've never made that choice, may this be a day of reckoning for us. May this be a day that makes a difference eternally for us. May we finally be humbled and say, Lord Jesus, I want you and I need you. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thanks for being here. It is our privilege and our pleasure to have you at New Hope on this Palm Sunday morning. If you are visiting for the very first time, there are visitor cards in the pew in front of you. I would love for you to take one, fill it out, drop it in the offering bag when it comes by next week through the mail. We will send you information about New Hope. We make a promise here. We will not beat on your door. We will not bother you on the phone. But through the mail, we'll send you information of what goes on around New Hope and hope that answers most of your questions for you. Let me get to this so that I can put it down, and then we'll get to the rest of our announcements. This is a water bottle. This is a water bottle that says Mexico Mission, New Hope 2014. This was a gift that was given to all 39 of our New Hopians who bailed out of here yesterday morning at 7:15 and arrived at about 6:15 in a little village outside of Rosarito, Mexico. And this was a surprise gift that every one of them got, all right? Now, they had 25 more bottles than they had people going to Mexico. Here's what I want to show you, how incredible sometimes things work. The Mexico mission team wants to bless the African mission trip next February. And so what is happening? In fact, can you all see a partial handprint two-thirds of the way up that wall over there? Can you see a little bit? Okay. Fawn did not do that. Though she would be the only one capable. No, Tim Belcher could have done it as well. Okay, you pick me up. All right. No, there's a couple of folks, Shelly and Debbie and Nancy and Teresa, that are working on VBS sets that will be going to Africa next February to do a first ever vacation Bible school in a village out in Africa. Now, here's the deal. These things have to be finished this week, so they could be on a truck next week, so they can arrive in Oklahoma City by April 30th, so they could be on a truck for Houston by May the 2nd, so that container could be on a ship that will arrive in the Ivory Coast, Africa by January. Okay? You guys hang with me on all that? All right. So, some of the guys on the Mexico team said, okay, we have 25 extra water bottles, so why don't you put them on a table out in the pavilion after church today and tell them For a $10 donation, they can have a free Mexico Mission water bottle that will help the VBS in Africa next year. That's kind of paying forward, isn't it? I think that's rather cool of them. So I said we would do that today. So if you see, it's got this cool little thingy, Bob, that you can attach it to your belt, okay? But here's my problem. When I did it, I couldn't get a drink from it. So I'm not sure what good that does me. But anyway, you all figure it out. The top does open, okay? And so it works rather cool. So that's, yeah, that's what that's all about. Let me highlight a few announcements and then a few prayer request updates that are not in your bulletin. This afternoon is our homeless outreach. So if you'd like to come back at 12:30, meet over in the Murbach building. They will be assembling sandwiches and bag lunches. And then they will caravan out to the homeless area in southwest Fresno, where they go the first Sunday of every month. I know this is the second Sunday. We had Roundup Sunday here last week, and so they pushed it off a week. However, the homeless are getting a double blessing because of that, because we had about almost 200 extra hamburgers barbecued last week that we didn't eat. And so they wrapped them up, and a couple of couples took them out and gave them to the homeless, and they'll be back this week. So it worked out kind of good. But if you would like to go today, if you've never been, it's a wonderful experience. They are meeting at 12:30. They usually finish up and get back here between 2:30 and 3 o'clock. This Sunday after the last service at 12:15, over in the Bridge building is going to be a meeting for those of you who volunteered to help out with the Special Olympics. John Realhorn will be meeting with you over there. This will not be a long meeting. This is not a training meeting. There's really nothing to train you for. This is going to be just a coordination meeting to know what time and where you're going to meet, and let you know about t-shirts that are coming and how we'll get those distributed to you. And so John will be meeting with you at 12:15 over in the Bridge building. Please take note of all the things that are not happening at the church this week, and take note of the times and things that are. Don't show up to the things that are not happening, and do show up to the things that are. Please note, schedule time for services next week, slightly different than normal. 8 o'clock is our first service. What's not normal about that is our 8 o'clock service will be right in here. Hi, guys. Good to see you. Welcome today. Oh, it's so good to see you. I knew she had, you don't have to hug me. She's good enough. Yeah. Okay, if you're visiting, I would never do that to you your first Sunday here, all right? They've been coming from, I married them, all right? So it's okay. It's okay. You come three Sundays, I might do it to you, but the first one I never would. Where was I? Oh, services next week. 3 morning Easter services. 8 o'clock will be in the sanctuary, not over in the other building. There'll be a 9:30 service, all right? So this service will not start at 9:15. This service will start at 9:30. The last service will not start at 10:45. It will start at 11 o'clock. So a little bit difference in time for Easter Sunday, all 3 services. 8 o'clock service will have toddler care and nursery care. Our other 2 services will be our full children's Sunday school and nursery care provided. So please take note of that. You will have a list of your Mexico mission team in here. You can be praying for them. They did arrive safely, and they got there before dark, and there were no accidents between here and there this year. All right? If you recall, last year, one of our vehicles got hit in Traver. We told them that Brittany could not stop in Traver this trip. All right. I can't imagine leaving Fresno and having to stop in Traver anyway, but they did, and so all went well this year, and we're grateful for that. Some prayer request updates that I need to share with you. One that I was just told about, and I don't have any details, but Terry Scarborough's mother had a stroke, I believe, this weekend, so please be remembering the Scarborough family. The Brown family, Jerry, not the governor, but a wonderful member of New Hope Church. His brother Doyle had a heart attack this week. He had a stent put in. He is still in ICU, and continue to pray for him as he recovers from the heart attack and the surgical procedure that was done. Bill from our 8 o'clock service got some pretty bad news this week in regards to cancer. I don't have all the details, but please be remembering Bill. Marcel Powers' husband is not doing well. We've been talking about him for a while, and please remember to pray for them. She has a meeting with Heinz Hospice tomorrow at 12:30, so would appreciate your prayers for the next few days for them. Dan Boitano, he and his wife Susan, most of the time 8 o'clock service, sometimes they're in this one. We've made this prayer request before, but Dan's father has Alzheimer's. And it advanced very, very quickly in the last 7 months, so much that they had to remove him from his home in the Bay Area, and he did not want to move. Still had enough of his memory to kind of get around home. The problem was when he took off to go to a haircut, nobody heard from him for 3 days. Credit card information finally showed that he had been at a hotel in Sacramento, a motel in Porterville, and how they finally found him was he walked into an AT&T store in Fresno and said, can you help me find my way home? And from his phone contacts, they were able to get in touch with his son. And so as a result of that, they had to bring him to town, and that wasn't easy. Things have continued to digress pretty rapidly, and Danny this week had to go and close up his father's home in Palo Alto, and that was very, very challenging for him. This is, as most those of you who've been through it with a loved one know, this is one of those cruel diseases in our world that you experience two deaths in. One in the loss of their memory, and then when physical death actually occurs. And one of the added issues with that is you get to a point that you feel guilty over the relief of the physical death. And yet there is, because you've been through so much leading up to that. And so just be praying for them. They were a little discouraged this morning. So I said I would share their concerns with you. Marianne, Milo's mother-in-law, Lisa's mom, had surgery last Monday. They removed a portion of her pancreas, a portion of her liver, a portion of her intestines, her gallbladder. Did some pretty major work on her. She does have pancreatic cancer. Haven't determined the stage yet. She is doing very well in recovery right now. She is still in CCU. The great news is there was no cancer found in any of the lymph nodes. And so that is great news. And so we just await more information as the days go by. I want you to be praying for a gentleman in our congregation. His name is Brian. He is in Fresno County Jail at the moment. Been part of our church family for a bit. His family is here. Down the road, I'll share a little bit more with you. But today, I just want to share with you to remember to pray for Brian. Fred Mindred from our congregation visited with him on Friday of this week. Fred went to encourage him, and Fred said, Tim, I'm getting to a place where I just can't wait for you to call me with somebody else to go visit, because for three times in a row now, he said, you've given me a name. I go thinking I'm really going to make them feel better. And he said, I walk out of there after hearing the stories of what God is doing in their life at this moment in this horrible place where Fred has been before. And he said, I walk away from there feeling so much better than when I arrived. And so just be praying for them, and that God will give us wisdom how we can be of the best support and help to Brian's family. I want you to be praying for this coming Saturday, Easter services at Valley State Prison for Men in Chowchilla. We'll be doing Easter services there. I get to be MC. I get to introduce Francis Chan, who will be preaching the Easter message. Those of you in small groups may know a little bit about Francis. Some of you have read some of his books. If you've been to Hume Lake over the years, he's been a regular speaker there. He'll be delivering the Easter message. There's a couple of musical groups that we'll be in, and we look forward to a great time in an Easter service this coming Saturday. So please be praying for us there. And just a side note, it's where my brother-in-law is incarcerated. And I don't get to speak to him. He can't approach me, but trust me, I'll be able to see him from a long ways off. If you don't know my brother-in-law, he's about 6'3 and about 320 pounds, all right? So he's pretty easy to spot in a crowd. But I'm looking forward to being there. And then Robert Shaw is not with us this morning because of some health issues and would request prayer. And then Judy Woodley handed me, I got a note from her today, please pray for my niece Sandra. She had surgery for a brain tumor. They could not get it all. So Monday, she will experience gamma knife radiation. So those are just a few updates that we wanted to share with you. Before we have our tithes and our offering this morning, we're going to do one of my favorite things to do in church. You've been here very long. You know what it is. Next to baptism, this may be one of my most enjoyable things to do. And that is a baby dedication. Every time new life comes into a family, it is a wonderful privilege. And every time it comes into the New Hope family, we are honored to be able to help celebrate with mom and dad and the grandparents that new arrival in their family. There's not one child that is any more special than another child. But there are some deliveries on occasion that do add a little something extra special. And this is one of those. And before I have them come up so I don't have them blubbering in front of everybody, let me just highlight the story. Many of you, if you've been at New Hope for the last 2 years, you know Ricky and Cody Cox. I had the privilege of marrying them and was so blessed and so honored that they started attending church here. And they're just delightful. Cody on occasions has pounded on the drums for us, and he's really good at it. And Ricky and was part of our Wednesday night group before we broke off into small groups. And most of us remember the first night that she came in with the great news that they were pregnant and expecting their first child. And we all celebrated and rejoiced with them. We also remember a few weeks later when Ricky showed up and shared with our Wednesday night small group that her pregnancy had some complications. She shared with us a very rare disease that I've now just forgotten the name. No, the one before that, Turner syndrome, okay? And I had to Google it, okay, and look it up and find out what Turner syndrome was. As we talked about it in our Wednesday night group, it just so happened that we did not have choir practice or worship team practice that night, and so Debbie Blankenship was in Wednesday night Bible study with us, and it just so happened, purely by accident, that she and Ricky were sitting at the same table right next to each other. Again, if you've been here very long, you know I don't believe in those kind of accidents or coincidences. And when I said Turner's syndrome, Debbie turned and looked at Ricky and says, "I have Turner syndrome." That's rather amazing, isn't it? And here you're wondering if what the health of your baby's going to be, and here's a person who has exactly what you don't know anything about. And so they commiserated a bit. We had special prayer that evening, and we were rather excited in light of the bad news. We were rather excited how things worked that particular evening. It was less than 2 weeks later, I believe, that she comes back on another Wednesday night to tell us that the diagnosis has been changed, and this is a trisomy 13 issue. Again, another issue I was not familiar with. I Googled it, found the information. And this is a situation where rarely do the babies live during the pregnancy. And if they are, there's lots of complications. And they rarely live more than 24 hours after their birth. The recommendation for most doctors are abortion. And Ricky chose not to go that route. Ricky said, I want to carry this baby to full term. And my heart's desire is that I would just get to hold my baby for a few minutes. And God honored that request. And they got to spend a night with little Eleanor. And if you've been here, you saw the pictures. We showed you the pictures. And what a joy that was. And Shelley and I were blessed and privileged to get to be there at Eleanor's arrival and to be with them the following day as well. Fast forwarding out of today, had to give you that so you understand why when I say, so none of you who I've dedicated your babies feel bad that Tim thinks this baby is more special than mine. That is not what I'm saying. But we've walked with Cody and Ricky through that journey, and they're kind of a bit like our own kids. And God blessed them with a very healthy pregnancy, and now they have a bouncing, bubbly baby boy. Is he starting to wake up and make noise? Okay, good, because I said I would wake him up in a minute. So, Ricky and Cody, would you bring that handsome little boy of yours up here and bring the grandparents who are here with you? Grandparents, we want you to share in this. Come right on up, guys. Come right on up. Please, grandparents, join them. They are bringing and introducing to us for the very first time Colton James Cox. All right. Turn him around. Turn him around so they can see him. Yeah. Here, turn sideways. There we go. There we are. Get a look at that boy. Oh, yeah. All right. Look at all that hair. Man, I had to wait 2 years for either one of my boys to have hair. And now neither one of them still have hair, all right? But anyway, Cody, Ricky, what a joy it is. Thank you for giving us the privilege and sharing in this moment with us. We have been honored, so very honored. And grandparents, thank you for sharing your time, particularly with Shelley and I on birthdays. It's been very special for us to be able to be a part of both of these occasions in your family. And there is another family observer who the Bible tells us in Hebrews chapter 12, we are surrounded by this great cloud of witnesses, those who've gone before us. They are standing at the banister of heaven, and they're cheering us on. And Eleanor is cheering her brother on today and saying, thank you. You represent not only the whole family, but me as well. And so I want to give you a challenge. I have no doubt that this baby will be well fed. I have no doubt this baby will be well clothed. I have no doubt that you'll always see that there is a roof over his head. And my challenge to you goes beyond those essentials. It's to something far more essential than food and clothing and housing. And that is the spiritual environment in which he'll be raised in. A mom and dad who will love him best when they love Christ most. A mom and dad who will realize he needs to learn his ABCs, but he also needs to learn about Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. A boy who may learn how to count, but also a boy who understands the 3 equals 1 and 1 equals 3. There is God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, and yet there is only one God. This is a young man who needs to know there is trouble in this world, and life comes with its share of troubles, but there is a safe place for him to live and find fellowship and comfort in, and it's a place called the church, where men and women who are not his relatives, but yet are his relatives, and who love him as their very own. And so if the two of you are willing to pray and to teach and to share the love of Christ with your son, Colton James Cox, would you say, we will? Perfect. Grandparents, you have a wonderful privilege and responsibility as well. You can support your son and daughter in their nurturing and their caring for him, but you can also support them with your prayers and honoring their wishes that their son, by teaching him about Jesus Christ, will not make him a Christian, but teaching him about Jesus Christ will give him the tools that he can make a decision of his own when he gets to that age. If you are willing to support them and their support of their son, would you say, we will? Terrific. Thank you very much. All right. Mr. Colton, will you come see me? Oh, come here. Look at... Oh, I should have worn my vest today, okay? Dang it, I almost did. I had a vest out, and I exchanged it for a coat. Here, we gotta pull it down here. Okay, look at this guy, man. Okay. Oh, I was told he might be a little stinky, so let me share it with the rest of the audience. I don't... Oh, we got cameras back here, so let's... Okay, I don't ever want to be selfish, so we will share the flavor of the month with you. All right, all the cameras are going off. Oh, look at... Oh, that is so sweet. Okay, we have paraded you enough. I'm going to ask that all of you join hands, if you would, as we have this very special prayer of commitment of Cody James to the Lord Jesus Christ. Our Father, just saying those words, our Father tells me you understand this moment far better than even we do. You created Adam, and then you sent your son. Just as you have blessed this family with a son, and it will be their job to train him, to love him, and to send him into the world, you sent your son, and your son was willing to come into this world to do for us what we could not do for ourselves. Colton will have a sphere of influence in his life that nobody else can have. And Father, I think he's going to have good lungs so that he'll be heard. And we just trust you. We know that you have plans and purposes that you would love to accomplish, and we trust that Colton will give you the freedom to exercise your will and your purpose in his life. We pray for his mom and dad. We commit to you their needs. Thank you for the blessings that you've already given to them, and we trust you for the future. We pray for their grandparents that they will support the choice of mom and dad. And so, Father, we just say thank you. In the name of Jesus Christ, for the difference this young man will make in our world. In Christ's name we pray. Amen and amen. Colton, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. You just wanted to be bounced a little bit, didn't you? I was talking to God and ignoring you for a moment, and you just didn't want that. All right. Mwah. Who gets him back? Mama? All right.
Okay.
There we go. Just a little bit of a gift from our church family. All right, just a certificate for this day, a place to put some pictures that they've been taking out there and to write some thoughts of this day so that somewhere down the road when he gets older, you can tell him how we embarrassed him thoroughly by walking him around with a dirty diaper. All right, and he'll be that one. And did you hold on just a moment? Somebody else brought you a gift, and I'll give this to you. And there is can I tell them what's in it? Because they probably can't open it right here. They'll do it when they get there. It's a quilt. Okay. for you. All right. So that's from the Brown small group. Thank you, buddy. Love you guys. Thank you, Granddad. All right. I'm going to invite our ushers to come forward and wait on us as we have our tithes and offerings. Would you join with me as we pray? Father, we give you great thanks for this incredible day. I normally don't like Palm Sunday. For those who've been here for a few years know that. I love this Palm Sunday. Thank you for the privilege of these last few minutes and the difference that it makes in our lives. Father, for the privilege of giving and sharing. It's a testimony that we believe that you can do more with our less than we can do with our all. And so thanks for the privilege of showing our trust in you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. I invite you to take your Bibles and find in John's Gospel chapter 12. In a few minutes we'll be reading from verse 12. So Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, and chapter 12. There are some cards on the table in the back. If you go out the foyer, if you go out the side door, just kind of sneak in the front door real quick, and on the tables there on the side. Actually, can I get one of our ushers who may be in the back? Okay. If you would take some of these and just put them out on the side table with the bottles, all right? Put about half the stack out there. You can pick up a half a dozen to 10 of these. Take them with you this week. Give them to your neighbor. Give them to a coworker. Give them to a relative or a friend. It just tells them where New Hope Church can be found, and it also tells them what time our services are. Shelley told me when we got these in on Thursday, she said, we got to go by Kirkland's. I said, what we got to go by Kirkland's for? She said, I had a great visit with a girl who works in there, and her husband want to come to visit New Hope. And so we got to take them an invitation. So after we had a burger at the Habit, no bun. Yeah. We went over and passed them out, and she said, "Oh, thank you so much. My husband and I'll be there. You just never know how you're going to meet somebody, and a conversation will start up. Put in their hand. We'd love to have them with us next Sunday morning. So they are there for you to use. I hope you will take advantage of them." Finding the newly appointed pastor standing in a study window in the church, weeping as he looked out over the inner city's tragic condition. A layman in the church wanted to encourage his pastor as he saw him standing there crying, and he walked up and he said, "Pastor, don't worry. After you've been here a while, you'll get used to it." And the pastor responded, "That's why I'm crying. That's why I'm crying." I don't want you and I ever to get used to our own plight as sinners. Though many of us in this room have invited Christ in our life and we have eternal life, I don't ever want us to get used to the fact that there is still within us the capacity for sin and failure. I don't want us ever to get used to the fact that even though the Bible says in this world there will be trouble, I don't want us to become complacent with the fact that we have got used to a world that's trouble and it's not my concern anymore. I don't even want us to get used to the message of Easter. Palm Sunday to Easter Sunday, the biggest, longest holiday celebration of a year around the world. Whether they all celebrate it right or not, it all has its roots out of the truth. The fact that some of it has gone off some degrees doesn't change the fact this celebration is worldwide. It's been going on for 2,000 years. No matter how hard people have tried to eliminate it, abolish it, to discredit it, it still stands. Yeah, you and I could say hallelujah. He saves. Hosanna. He saves. And bless you. I wished I could sneeze cute. But, you know, it's so nice when that happens. If y'all were here for the pie auction, you heard how I sound when I sneeze. Yeah, right over the big cake. But no, I'm kidding. That didn't happen. That did not happen. But I don't want us to get used to Easter. As most of you know, if you've been here for a Palm Sunday or two, I don't like Palm Sunday. It's the hardest Sunday of the year for me to prepare a sermon. I don't like the message of the triumphal entry. I find nothing triumphant about it. Most of the folks lining the streets of Jerusalem were misguided or hypocritical or both. They were looking for a handout rather than redemption. They were looking for someone who would make their life more comfortable rather than redeemed. They were going to shortchange the gift that the Messiah was coming to bring. They were looking for better politics rather than a personal relationship with a living God. I don't want us to get used to the story. So my prayer is today, as we read the story of Palm Sunday and as we make some observations, that we will invite God to reveal to us something out of this story that will grab our attention. Something out of this event that will prompt us to look at ourselves and say, oh God, here's an area of my life. Here's an area of my life that I've missed. And I don't want you to miss it anymore in my life. Will you just privately take a moment, pray something along those lines that God, out of His Word, will teach you something about yourself and your relationship with Him. Chapter 12, verse 12, Gospel of John reads like this. Is anybody getting cold? Okay, turn the outside coolers off, leave the inside one on. All right, outside's off, inside on. Okay, perfect. The next day, the great crowd that had come for the feast. What feast? Feast of the Passover. All right, biggest feast, Jewish feast celebration of the year. Probably it's kind of like Christmas for us, all right? Big event. People from all over the world at that time are going to come to the city of Jerusalem for the purpose of this feast. And while they're there for the feast, they heard that Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem. They took palm branches and went out to meet him, and they shouted, Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the King of Israel. Jesus found a young donkey, and he sat upon it. For it is written, do not be afraid, O daughter of Zion. See, your king is coming, seated on a donkey's colt. Just a brief pause in the reading. I want you to understand, that verse is a prophecy that was being fulfilled in front of their very eyes. That prophecy had been prophesied about 800 years before. That is one prophecy of 300 plus prophecies in the Old Testament about the life of Jesus Christ. Prophecies that were minimally 400 years old and some of them 1,000 and 1,200 years old. Statisticians who are much smarter than I am about numbers have said it this way. Just for 10 of those 300 plus prophecies from hundreds of years before, for just 10 of those to have happened in the life of one man in a 33-year span, the possibility of that happening is 1 out of 10 to the 27th power. I have no idea, folks, what you call that number. That's 10 with 27 zeros, and you got to put a comma after every third one, all right? I could go 100, 1,000, million, billion, trillion, quadrillion, gazillion. Are y'all starting to make them up now? And I think we're just about halfway there. Okay? What those same statisticians tell us is that 1 to 10 in the ninth power. Okay? This was to the 20th. 1 to 10 in the ninth power is impossible. So, this happening in the life of Jesus is 3 times impossible. So, what does that tell us? It's a God thing, isn't it? When there's no other explanation but God, that is how we define a miracle. He must have been who he said he was. You can't pull this off without it being real. And this story, and we looked at it last year, we looked at the whole donkey thing in last year's Palm Sunday message. That's just 1 of the 10 of the 300 plus. Verse 16. At first, his disciples did not understand all this. It was only after Jesus was glorified that they realized these things had been written about him and that they had done these things to him. Now the crowd was with him when he called Lazarus from the tomb and raised him from the dead, and they continued to spread the word. Many people, because they had heard that he had given this miraculous sign, went out to meet him. They didn't care about what he had to say. They just wanted to see what he was going to do next. So the Pharisees said to one another, "See, this is getting us nowhere. Look how the whole world has gone after him." The Pharisees are ticked because the crowds who used to come for the feast of the Passover came to the Pharisees for direction. And now on this Palm Sunday, the Pharisees are being ignored, and Jesus is getting their attention. I want you to play a mind game with me, if you will, for a few minutes this morning. I want you to imagine that it's 2,000 years back. You were in the city of Jerusalem. You were lining the streets, and it's early morning hours of Palm Sunday. This great crowd has gathered to celebrate the Feast of the Passover. It is something that you and I might see only in Times Square on New Year's Eve. That's probably what it looked like in Jerusalem that day. Josephus, who was the notable Jewish historian who lived at that time, first century historian, he estimated that over 2 million people were involved in the great Passover feast. It is known that 256,000 lambs were slain at this one Passover, and that each lamb represented at least 10 worshipers. That's 2.5 million people were there. Teeming thousands from all over the world were flooded in the city to observe this Passover, this remembrance of how God delivered Moses and Israel from Egyptian captivity. The mass of people, the necessary housing, the food arrangements to handle such a mass of people is hard for us to imagine. An excitable carnival-like atmosphere was bound to prevail over such a mob of people. Lots of people were jamming the city streets. They were getting ready for this festive celebration. But as they prepared to observe one of the most important feasts that they celebrated every single year, word filtered throughout the city, Jesus, the miracle worker, was coming to town. It is a rare thing that all four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, record the exact same event of Jesus' life. Sometimes one or two Gospels will record an event. On more rare occasions, three Gospels will record. But on this particular day in Jerusalem, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John all chose to write about it. It obviously should be important for us to consider what they had to say. The crowds gather as Jesus rides into the city on the colt of a donkey, and they begin to wave their palm branches and throw down their coats, and they shout an incredible welcome to Jesus Christ. Kind of like you and I when we sing our opening song at church. It's you and I lifting our voices up to say, God, you are welcome in this place. But the question is, who are the faces in the crowd that day? Really, who? You see, it's one thing for us to say there was a crowd. It's one thing for me to say, hey, the 9:15 service. It's another thing for me to say, Tammy Harris. It's another thing for me to say, Marvin, Jerry, Jim, Tim, Barb, Mansfield. Another thing for me to point you out, call you by name. You're recognized, you're known. You're a person, not a cluster. If you were there that day, which group of folks would you have identified with? If you had been present on the streets of Jerusalem as Jesus comes in on the back of a young donkey colt, which group, which person, which people, which personality type would you have identified with those who were there? I want to take a few minutes this morning, and I want to examine that crowd that was there, and I want us to think about ourselves. Where would we have been? I'm confident that in that crowd were Roman soldiers. This was their territory. It was their responsibility for crowd control. As the crowd began to honor Jesus, I'm sure the Roman soldiers were giving this a great deal of attention. They were charged with keeping the Jewish people under control, and after all, it was Passover, and there were lots of Jews in Jerusalem. What did this demonstration mean to the Romans themselves? Nothing is recorded about their viewpoint of the Passover feast, but it's certain they kept a close watch that day. For during the annual Passover feast, it was not uncommon for some Jewish zealots like Barabbas to try to arouse the people to fight back against the Roman occupation of their city. Maybe they thought the parade was going to be some kind of rebellion event. Maybe they were expecting to quell a riot. But all of a sudden, here comes Jesus. And I think the Roman soldiers might have been a little curious about Jesus. I mean, they're saying, King of the Jews! We haven't seen a king. And they look down the street to see who's leading the parade. And here comes Jesus on a baby donkey. I imagine they must have smiled and said, this is what you call a triumphant victory? This is a victory celebration? Because the Roman soldiers, they knew what a victorious celebration looked like. For whenever a Roman general was victorious on foreign soil, what did victorious mean to them? If he had killed at least 5,000 of the enemy, if he had gotten new territory, and if he had captured some of the enemy leadership, he was victorious. And they would have what was known as a Roman triumph celebration. When the guy would return to the city, they would have what the Americans would call a ticker tape parade, only on a much bigger scale. The general would ride into the city in a gold-covered chariot pulled by white stallions. That's the symbol of a warrior, not an infant donkey. The general would display the trophies that he had won. The enemy leaders would have ropes around their neck and be pulled behind the chariot. They would be paraded down the street. The parade would end at the arena where some of the captives would entertain the people by fighting wild beasts. I am confident some of these Roman soldiers laughed at the antics of the Jerusalems and the crowd that day at the sight of a so-called king. What real king would ride a donkey? What powerful leader would stoop so low? They probably found it amusing compared to the Roman triumph. Our Lord's entry into Jerusalem was nothing. Think about the entrance of Jesus into this world. It took place in a quiet little town called Bethlehem in the middle of the night with no noise, no splash, no celebration. His entrance into Jerusalem had a bit more notice, a bit more fanfare, but still very, very humble. You see, for Jesus, it wasn't his entrance that was important. It was his exit that was most important. You see, it's the way he left the brow of Golgotha's hill and he left an empty tomb behind. It was not his arrival in Jerusalem that we celebrate for 2,000 years. It was his exit. And that's what makes all the difference in the world. Compared to a Roman celebration, our Lord's entry was nothing. But isn't that how a lot of people think about Jesus today? He's nothing. You probably have friends and maybe even family members that Jesus is nothing to them. That they may go along with you to church on Christmas or Easter only to shut you up for a while. But they really don't understand all the excitement. They laugh at you behind your back and they laugh at him in front of his face. There are a lot of people who sometimes out loud, but if not out loud, quietly say, how could sophisticated, intelligent people in the 21st century be so ignorant as to believe in Jesus Christ? I mean, you really believe the stuff that Jesus makes the blind to see? He really makes the lame to walk? He really made deaf to hear? He really walked on water? He really calmed the storm with just a word from his mouth? This guy really took 5 loaves of bread? Oh, that means there was gluten. It must be okay. It must be okay. Okay? He took 5 loaves of bread and 2 fishes and he distributed it to the entire crowd and there were 12 basketfuls left. I mean, who in their right mind believes that kind of stuff? They laugh at Christians who have faith in the Jesus of Nazareth. You see, the reason they laugh is because many people, they want a God. But they want a God they can control. And a God who can heal the sick and walk on water and feed thousands with 5 loaves. That's a God they cannot control. And they don't want that kind of God because that kind of God puts them out of the God business. And that's what the Pharisees and that's what the Roman soldiers didn't want to be put out of the God business. Speaking of the Pharisees, they're going to be one of the groups we look at in just a few minutes. But before we get to them, let's look at a second group of folks who were in the crowd that day. Go back to a few verses earlier in John chapter 12. Go to verse 9. Meanwhile, a large crowd of Jews found out that Jesus was there and came, not only because of him, but also to see Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. Before Jesus had come to Jerusalem, he spent some time with Mary and Martha and Lazarus in Bethany, good friends of his. We see another large crowd is gathered, but John says they were there not really to see Jesus, they were there to see Lazarus. Lazarus was a rare breed. Lazarus was dead, buried, and the scripture says he'd been buried so long he now stinks. And it wasn't with a dirty diaper. He just stunk. And they wanted to see this guy who smelled up the place. They wanted to see what he was like. They wanted to see what was going on. These were people who wanted to see the show, not the master. They wanted to know what was going on. They weren't really interested in what Jesus wanted to accomplish. These are people who were halfway sincere seekers. They see the crowd gathering at dinner that Jesus was attending, and they wanted to be part of the action. They just didn't want to let the action be part of them. You see, the crowd had come to see the spectacular. They wanted to see Lazarus, the man rumored to be raised from the dead. They were anxious to see what dead men walking looked like. They wanted to see if a resurrected man was any different than just another man. Does he walk the same? Does he talk the same? Does he eat the same? What's he like? And then the other parts of that crowd came for the social benefits. It was a very festive atmosphere. They wanted to be part of the banquet. Wherever Jesus was, man, things were happening. And they wanted to be where it was happening. They wanted to join the party, not a relationship with Jesus Christ. Isn't that why some people come to church? They want some good business contacts. Hey, the socials are great. Man, do those church people know how to make desserts? They are good. They come for social activities. They come maybe to see if, like Lazarus, they can get in on the good stuff. And I'm going to tell you, look out if dessert is some of the good stuff. I was at the senior luncheon this week. I nearly got trampled at the dessert table. Okay? It's good. You see, these folks in that crowd were there to get what they can. They weren't there to worship a king. They were there to see the miracles, not to see the king. John 12:18 says, many people, because they had heard that he had given this miraculous sign, went out to meet him. I wonder how many sitting in the presence of the Lord in churches around the country today are only half sincere. How many seek the spectacular signs only, but no relationship with the Master? John chapter 6, verse 30 says, so they asked Christ, what miraculous sign will you give that we might see it and believe you? What will you do? That's the attitude of a lot of folks. Jesus, what are you going to do for me so I can believe in you? What will you give me? God, give me the promotion at work and I'm yours. God, make my spouse happier. I'm yours. It's kind of like trying to build a bridge to Hawaii. There's a joke there, but I don't have the time to tell it. Have Gene tell it to you one of these days. It's a good one. God, I want my kids to behave better. Take care of that, will you? God, I want a Harley. Actually, I'm not a big bike rider, but I wouldn't mind one. Red and white. Pretty cool looking. God, I'd like a newer car. God, how about a great health checkup? God, if you do that for me, then maybe I'll be yours. What if God were to say, how about I give you a demotion so you can have a better attitude? What if God says to you, how about instead of you worrying about your spouse being happier, why don't you be better to your spouse? Yeah, who just said amen? I heard a couple. All right. How about instead of me making your kids nicer, why don't you be better at parenting? Mark 7:6, Jesus replied, Isaiah was right when he prophesied about you hypocrites. It is written, these people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. There were a lot of people in the crowd that day saying, Hosanna, hallelujah. Their lips professed, but their hearts were very far from them. Because it is this same cluster of people who 4 days later yell, crucify him. He deserves to be dead. Matthew 28:28 says, in the same way, on the outside you appear to be people that are righteous, but on the inside you are full of hypocrisy and wickedness. I wonder how many then, as well as today, wanted the miracles but missed the master. There were probably some of those in the crowd that day. Third group, religious leaders were there. Verse 19, chapter 12. The Pharisees said to one another, see, this is getting us nowhere. Look how the whole world has gone after him. Wouldn't you think that's what they would have wanted? As the Pharisees, they should have been the one on the lookout. They should have been the first one to have spotted the Messiah. They should have been the ones to tell the people, follow him. It is what John the Baptist said, wasn't it? John the Baptist said, hey guys, stop following me. Follow him, for he is the one whose shoes, whose sandals, I am not even worthy to take off his feet. The Pharisees, instead of pointing others to Jesus, they had to discredit him. They had to bring him down. You see, wherever the power was, that's where you would find the Pharisees. Wherever the prestige was, that's where they could be. They wanted the praise. They wanted the glory. They wanted to be looked up to. They wanted to be the ones with the influence. They were fine as long as they were the center of attention. But look out if somebody else got in their way. People were beginning to come to Jesus and follow him. And the Pharisees knew that meant powerful positions were in jeopardy. Isn't it sad and tragic that religious positions become political? Isn't it sad that men reject Christ for the things of this world? Isn't it awful that men and women swap eternity for social and political gain? These preachers and teachers, these church leaders of the first century were only interested in themselves. They were only interested in the prestige of their positions. They were going to oppose anybody and anything that threatened with their little house of cards. And folks, God is never pleased with this kind of leadership. Ezekiel 34:2-3 tells us what God thinks about it. He says, son of man, prophesy against the shepherds of Israel. Prophesy and say to them, this is what the sovereign Lord says. Woe to the shepherds of Israel who only take care of themselves. Should not shepherds take care of the flock? You eat the curds. You clothe yourself with wool. You slaughter the choices of animals, but you do not take care of the flock. You see, the Pharisees did something that I'm afraid is growing in prevalence in the 21st century. We think we're coming up with new stuff all the time, and really we're just recycling a lot of the old stuff. And this is one of them. The Pharisees confused self-worth with net worth. And I think that happens a lot today. We look at our bank account, we look at our possessions, either the abundance of or the lack of, and we associate that with our value. If you hear nothing else today, and it's a repeat from last Sunday morning, the price tag has already been put on your life. Your value has already been placed on your life. You are not the one who puts the price tag. Others do not put the price tag. God himself put a price tag on you. And you know what that price tag says? Priceless. He sent his son to a cross to bear a crown of thorns, to let nails rip through his flesh, to let a spear pierce his side. And on that he put priceless. You are invaluable to God. Your net worth, however good that may be, could never equal the price that God has put on you. And sometimes, in fact, all the time, Pharisees confuse spiritual vitality with spiritual activity. They rated maturity by what they did. How often they would go to church, to Sabbath, how many studies that they would do every week, how many times they would read the scriptures. And you and I become vulnerable to the enemy's distractions when we use a wrong measuring stick for our worth. When we rate ourselves by what we do rather than who he is. When we rate ourselves by how big our congregation is compared to somebody else. When we measure our worth by how many people are following us, by what we say and do on Twitter and on Facebook. And there's a couple of new ones out there. Somebody just mentioned them in last service. Instagram. What was the other one? LinkedIn. Yeah, I hate that one. They send me three notices every day. Your friend wants you on LinkedIn. I don't even know that friend. All right? But we get all caught up, and I love it because we want people, all those folks, to know when I need to go to the bathroom, and we type it in and we tell them. And then they all respond, like, really? Really? But we do these things, and we find our value there. There are many in church today who want visible positions. They want power. They want influence. They want to be movers and shakers. They want to gain a following. They'll say anything to be popular. They'll preach a prosperity gospel. Come to Jesus and all your cares and troubles will be over. Come to Him. He'll give you what you want. No, He won't. He'll give us what we need. And sometimes what we need is exactly the opposite of what we want at the moment. There are folks who will say and preach anything to get a crowd to follow them. They want people to follow them and not God. Isaiah 56:11 says, "They are dogs with mighty appetites. They never have enough. They are shepherds who lack understanding. They all turn to their own way, and each seeks their own gain." Yes, there are even those bad shepherds in the crowd that day, and they went so far as to plot a way to do away with Jesus. The Apostle Paul offers us a stark contrast to this line of thinking. The man whom God chose to pen half the New Testament reduced it down to this one truth. And I don't have very much time today, so I want to introduce this verse to you quickly. Don't turn there, but sometime in the next week, go read 2 Corinthians 11:3. Wayne Cordero wrote a book I read on the airplane to Africa, and it has challenged me in a way I haven't been challenged in years. This verse, I'm sure I've read it, but I read right over it. Here's what verse 3 says. Don't let the devil lead you astray from what is pure and what is simple about walking with Jesus. Pharisees tried to make religion complicated. Jesus has come to make a relationship simple. He didn't come to complicate the gospel. He came to simplify it. That's why it's good news. Wouldn't it be great if somebody came out with a new tax code book and it said, pay 5% of your total income? Wouldn't that be awesome? That would be great. That would be good news. Jesus Christ has given us a simpler one that has eternal consequences, not yearly consequences. Jesus said, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. Anyone and everyone can come to the Father through me. Nobody gets there apart from me. Isn't that pretty simple? I don't have to figure out who's right or wrong. I just need to know that Jesus is the way. In fact, if you ever find another man or woman who lived 33 years, never had an army, never had a home, never had any money in the bank, never wrote a book of his own, who said, I'm going to live, I'm going to die, and 3 days later I'm going to raise from the dead, who had 500 plus witnesses to the fact of that reality, and 2,000 years later the world is still talking about him. If you find somebody else that had that kind of influence, follow them. But I haven't found one. Jesus made it simple. I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. The reason the leaders of the church were convinced that the average follower could not understand the scriptures is because they wanted to keep the average follower under their thumb. They thought the average guy on the street needed one of the knowledgeables to tell them what the scripture means. It's one of the reasons I love small groups, because there aren't pastors in most of the small groups. And you guys get to sit down together around a table in a living room somewhere, and you get to open your Bible, and guess who your teacher gets to be? God Himself. The person of the Holy Spirit. And He takes our pooled ignorance and He teaches us what we could never understand apart from Him. We don't need somebody to tell us. God will be happy to tell us if we have a passion to discover. It's time to get back to Jesus, pure and simple. Modern day Pharisees work hard at following rules and creeds. They put great effort in being right. But being right isn't wrong. It's how they steward their being right that is wrong. Did you guys stay up with me on that one? That's a tongue twister. All right, let me say it one more time. They put great effort into being right. Being right isn't wrong, but it's how we steward being right that is wrong. Let me give you another tongue twister. You are never closer to being completely wrong as when you are convinced that you are absolutely right. Huh? Let me see if I can expand. The religious leaders in Jesus' day were confident. They were absolutely right. Jesus was a con man. They were convinced that Jesus was a rebel bent on stirring the crowds. So what did they do? They stirred up the crowds. Their sense of rightness produced hatred, slander, deception, disrespect, and in 4 days, murder. When you're absolutely right, when you know in the bottom of your heart you're absolutely wrong, your attitude of being absolutely right condones the most sinful acts you can imagine. In each of us is a Pharisee waiting to mature and be turned loose. An early symptom of self-righteousness surfaces when we begin to judge others based on their actions and ourselves based on our intentions. A second symptom to know that the Pharisee is about ready to slip out of you is when we are confident that God dislikes the same people we do. No room for prejudice in God's family. It's probably a prejudicial song a bit today, but its attempt was to try to explain that in God's family there is none. Red and yellow, black and white, they are precious in His sight. Old or young, whatever culture, the person you hate, God loves. And those who hated you, He still loved you. It's time to get back to Jesus, pure and simple. These were the types of people in the crowd that day, those who were amused and laughed, those who wanted to join the party and get what they could, and the ones who wanted the power and the prestige. Let me wrap this up, about 2 minutes. The most important group that was there that day, I trust we will find many of them here today. Verse 20 and 21 of chapter 12. Now there were some Greeks among those who went up to worship at the feast. I find the terminology interesting. They're not the Jews. They're not the Pharisees. They're the Greeks who came to town to share in the feast. And they went to Philip and they asked, "Sir, we would like to see Jesus. We would like to see Jesus." Do you wake up every morning with that thought on your mind? I want to see Jesus' actions today. For when we see Him, we will then worship Him and we will glorify Him. We will humbly bow in His presence. We will sing as the people did there, but I hope from a right heart instead of a wrong perspective. Hosanna! That word Hosanna means He who saves. But He who saves to the uttermost. He who saves from the inside out, not from the outside in. He who cares about our eternal destiny, not our political futures. God who comes to save our soul, redeemed, redeemed. I am not, thank God, who I used to be. I have been redeemed. Wow. With this, I'll close. There was a discouraged rabbi in the Siberian tundra who had gone for a walk and wandered quite a ways from his home. He was discouraged and disenchanted with his ministry and his life, and he aimlessly ambled into the wintry night. The only thing that was colder than the evening air was the chill in his own soul. He was discouraged and aimlessly wandered by mistake into the nearby Russian military compound that was off limits to all civilian personnel. The only sound was the crunch of freshly fallen snow under his boots, and when the evening was still broken by the brash bark of a Russian soldier brandishing a big rifle. "Hey," he shouted, "who are you and what are you doing here?" The rabbi thought for a moment and he looked up and he asked, "How much do they pay you each day?" "What does that have to do with anything?" The rabbi said, "I will pay you the same sum of money if you will ask me that question every morning. Who are you and what are you doing here?" I want to be a Russian soldier for you today. On this Palm Sunday, I want to be the voice that asks you a question. Who are you and what are you doing here? Are you here just to get what you can? Are you here for the action, the social? Are you here for a little power and influence? Or are you here to find, see, worship Jesus? Who are you? What are you doing here? You see, it's time to examine the way we live. Throw off the yoke of foolishness and Phariseeism and get back to Jesus pure and simple. I hope every one of you could answer, "I'm not fully sure of who I am, but I know I'm not who I used to be, for I am one of the redeemed." Let's pray. Our Father, I trust Your Spirit can accomplish what the lips of mortal men cannot. And that is, You will take Your truth and take it to the very heart of our being as you took the words of John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son," and you pierced the heart of a 5-year-old boy nearly 54 years ago. You enabled him to walk down an aisle in a Christian camp and say, "I don't want to go to hell, I want to go to heaven." I know who the preacher was, but I don't know anything else he said. But I know he said that you loved me so much that you gave your Son for me so that I could have everlasting life. So, Father, I pray that your Spirit has the liberty to take your truth, pierce our hearts, and do to us only what you can do with our permission. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.